Hi, I'm Dr. Gina Mackenzie, host of the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on CCP-TV, the educational channel of the Community College of Philadelphia. Tonight we have with us Stephanie Scordia, instructor at the Community College of Philadelphia. Stephanie has her BA from Cedar Crest College in Communications Arts and her MA in English from Westchester University. She is an instructor here at the college and prior to that was a reporter for The Signal in Oregon. She has presented her work at the Pennsylvania Colleges English Association Conference, at the two-year College Association Conference, and at the Mid-Atlantic Popular Culture Association Conference. So we're lucky to have her with us tonight to share some of her fiction and her ideas on writing. Welcome, Stephanie.
Thank you for having me, Gina.
A pleasure. So what does it mean to be a writer in contemporary society?
A writer is something that I think is very hard to define. In some ways. You know, we do so many different kinds of writing in contemporary society that depending on the purpose of the writing and the intended audience of the writing, it can look wildly different from, you know, from one context to the next.
Talk a little bit about the move from being a reporter, which is a very specialized kind of writing, to going into fiction writing, or even to being an instructor of writing here at the college.
Well, being a reporter is, there is a lot of creativity there. I always try to say, a lot of times when people think about, you know, newspaper writing or reporter writing, they think that it's, because it's nonfiction, that it doesn't have an element of creativity, which it does. I would say that perhaps one of the biggest differences between working as a reporter as opposed to doing academic writing would be that, you know, as a reporter, you're out there doing that interface with other humans, mm-hmm. right? When you're doing academic writing, a lot of times you're using sources, but you're finding them in print. You're not actually, you know, communicating in the right. literal sense with the authors of the sources that you're using.
And how about in writing fiction?
And fiction writing is something that just completely, you know, I've never like studied officially. I took one creative writing class as an undergrad, and other than that, my sort of you know, adventures with fiction are based on just my own reading of fiction, and then just trying it, just taking a flying leap.
Just playing with words.
Just playing with words, exactly. Yeah. So to me, that it seems, and I'm sure that other writers of fiction would not necessarily agree, but I think that it's probably the most liberating in terms of all the different writing that you can do, academic versus writing for print media versus fiction. I do think that writing fiction is the most liberating.
What makes it freeing for you?
Because it's unless you decide that you want to share it with an audience, it can be very private. If you're writing for a newspaper, there's no privacy there. You know, you're
right.
Same thing with academia. You know, you at least have to share it with your professor, right?
At the most basic,
exactly. Fiction, I mean, I've got a number of poems and short stories that I've never shared with anyone. So it can be very private, and in that sense, I think it's more free. You can be more free as a writer than maybe forms where you know that they're going to be received by an audience. Because I think in the back of our minds, we always have the idea of the critic, you know?
Ah.
And so if you know that you're writing something because it's going to get published in a paper, newspaper, or you're writing something that you know that is going to get graded by, you know, in class, You know that there's an evaluation that's happening there. You know that there's going to be some criticism. If you're writing fiction or any other kind of sort of, you know, journaling, memoir, you know, which is, you know, creative nonfiction, you don't have to share that. You know, the audience can sort of just be you and the page, and so you might be more free because you're not worried about that criticism or that evaluation.
So there's no censorship then for you when you're writing fiction.
Exactly.
Interesting. I think that is different than a lot of other writers who sort of internalize that critic even when they're writing fiction or poetry. That's terrific for you. You mentioned a little bit about freedom and language. What makes language such an important aspect of creating fiction? I mean, in terms of syntax, in terms of word choice, because that's something in reading your work that you're very careful with.
Mm-hmm. You can't, I think, stress enough the importance of language, right? I mean, you can change one word in a sentence and have a completely different meaning. And this one thing that I tell my students a lot, like I shared with them a quote the other day from Nathaniel Hawthorne, of all people, talking about how words, how innocent they are, you know, in the dictionary, how potent they can become in the hands of the person who knows how to use them. And, you know, we kind of talked about that a little bit. And one of the things that we sort of all came to an agreement upon was that, yeah, you know, you can change one word, a word that carries more, say, emotional weight than another, and the reaction or the response that you could get from your audience could be completely different. So there's a lot of control. You know, if you can control words, you can control your audience and their opinion. Which to me, I mean, you know, so the power of words. And it's something that obviously, as you know, working as a reporter, I was aware of, and in my academic writing, but even certainly within fiction, again, if you want to share that fiction with your audience, I think, you know, you spend a lot of time thinking about, you know, changing words in the revision process. You know, when I first sit down and write something, I don't worry about words at all, the specific words. You know, I just kind of get the ideas down. But when revising.
The craft comes in with how you use language then.
Exactly.
Interesting. And I think I'll tip our hand to the audience a little bit. The word red certainly can be just a color, but in your story comes to be much more emotionally important than just its sort of first appearance in the first several sentences of your work.
Right.
So it'll be great for us to hear that in a few minutes. Talk about your writing process a little bit.
Well, again, usually when it comes to the creative writing, I just get ideas. I'm not a very disciplined creative writer. I don't sit and spend a certain number of minutes each day working on a piece. I have an unfinished novel that's been sitting on my you know, desktop for about 2 years now.
That's okay.
Because I kind of, only when the inspiration hits do I actually put, you know, pen to paper or fingers to, you know, keypad. So it's not, you know, again, I don't have that discipline. I've read, you know, things from other writers who say that, you know, every day you must write. Even if you end up with a sentence that you end up keeping at the end, you know, the process of writing every day is crucial. And I believe that. And for some reason, I can't make myself do it when it comes to my own fiction. Particularly like my poetry, that just seems to come out of nowhere. Like, I really couldn't, it's not like I think I want to write a poem about this and then I spent time thinking about it the way that I would with an academic paper, right? If I was given a topic, I'm going to brainstorm, my creative writing process is nowhere near that. It's just something that really, the ideas just come, sometimes based on things that I see walking around the city. I think, you know, living in a city like Philadelphia, it's almost impossible not to be inspired to create something, some kind of.
That's a beautiful tribute to the city, too.
Well, do you find that to be?
I do. I think living in an urban, exciting area inspires us in many artistic ways.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I would completely agree with that. And the story that you're going to share with us today has a lot of Philadelphia flavor and is very clearly connected to the city.
Mm-hmm.
Could we hear that now and then talk a little bit about how you were specifically inspired?
Okay, yeah.
Great.
All right. So the story is called Rooftops. Looking back, I wish there'd been a sign, some kind of omen, something to warn me of what lay ahead. As a kid, I was fascinated by stories of trading ships and pirates and adventures on the high seas. Those stories were full of old sayings like, red sky at night, sailor's delight, red sky at morning, sailor take warning. If only the sky had been red that morning, I might have done things differently. I would have gone straight home after work. I wouldn't have stopped off at Lorenzo's for that damn slice of pizza. We wouldn't have met, and none of this would have happened. But that morning started out like any other. 8:30 a.m. Reaching over, I turned off the alarm, then lay in bed for another 30 minutes, debating whether it was even worth showering on such a hot day, since I was bound to be sweating 2 seconds after leaving the shower. Telling myself I was helping conserve water, I decided to skip the shower and walk down the hallway to my kitchen. The brown and gold linoleum was cool on my bare feet. Opening the refrigerator, I took out a carton of orange juice and a banana. I usually disapprove of keeping bananas in the fridge, but these were spoiling in the heat before I got a chance to eat them. The peels were a mottled brown, but the banana itself was fine. Turning the window fan on high, I sat at the table and listened to the clock tick seconds away. I willed myself to be cooler. But it didn't work. A few minutes later, I walked down 3 flights of stairs to the concrete sauna outside. The hallway was dark as always. There are no windows in the hall, and the landlord, Gus, has yet to replace the burned-out bulbs. I knew I'd have to call him again. I'd called him 3 times already, but maybe with Greeks, the 4th time is the charm. Walking out my front door, I was instantly greeted with, "Hey, how you been?" "Good," I replied, smiling wide at Rocky, the black watchdog. "Pretty hot out today." "Yeah, it's supposed to be 98, they said. I don't know Rocky's full story. Never without his aviator sunglasses and worn-out Navy cap, Rocky stands about 4 feet 11 inches, and in colder weather wears an old black bomber jacket with a sheep's wool at the collar. In the summer months, every few weeks he opens the fire hydrant on our block and releases enough water to cause a mini flood. I doubt he's ever seen Taxi Driver, or any movie for that matter, but whenever he opens the hydrant, I think of Travis Bickle's rants about cleaning the filth off the streets. I wonder if he'll open the hydrant today. The street is looking a little dirty, but that's part of living in Little Hanoi. Okay, no one calls it that but me. I've also tried calling my neighborhood Sowa, as in south of Washington, but that hasn't caught on either. It just doesn't seem fair that other neighborhoods in South Philly have a name. Bella Vista, Penceport, Grace Ferry, Queen Village, Girard Estates, while my neighborhood goes nameless, like some bastard child. "Well, I'll see you later," I said, fishing for my SEPTA pass in my backpack. "Yeah, I'll be seeing you." Rocky resumed his post at the corner, hands in pockets, eyes hidden behind those giant reflective lenses. It was really hot that day, so hot I could feel the sweat gathering in my jeans with each step. It seems like cruel and unusual punishment to require employees to wear long pants in the summer. Then again, every aspect of my job seems like punishment. After taking a quick look around to make sure no one's looking, I checked my armpits. Damp already. Gross. And that stupid coffee stain never came out completely. It faded a little, but sits there as a reminder of how awful my job is. The guy didn't even apologize when he bumped into me, and then acted like it was my fault I spilled his precious cappuccino. My manager, Eve, saw the whole thing, but of course had to take the customer's side. Every day I tell myself, today, you will quit. You will, in the middle of making some self-important hipster an overpriced hot caffeinated beverage, simply walk out of the shop, never to return. Oh, to be free from that small, confined space surrounded by people who are so self-absorbed that they keep their heads buried in their books and papers, and I doubt they'd look up even if someone were to set themselves on fire. Someday. Waiting for the 47 bus on the corner, I tried to take shallow breaths. The poultry shop on the corner smells worse on hot days, and the giant fan blows the stink on passersby. I'm not a vegetarian or anything, and I suppose it isn't any worse to go to a butcher's, pick out a chicken, and have it slaughtered fresh for you than the way I do it, picking up my Purdue skinless, boneless thighs at the frozen aisles from the frozen meats aisle in Acme. If anything, the corner butcher shop seems more natural, but the sight and smell of those birds all caged up and squawking and pecking at each other makes me gag every time I walk by. When I first moved to the neighborhood, it was a Jewish butcher shop. Now it's owned by a Vietnamese family, like most of the businesses around 7th and Greenwich. Hence, Little Hanoi, see? I don't know why that hasn't caught on. A short Vietnamese man wearing high black rubber boots was hosing down two large white plastic pails in front of the shop. Cages of chickens and ducks lined the sidewalk. A middle-aged Hispanic woman, pushing a stroller with a child too large for it, passed by, staring at the caged birds. I don't know any Spanish, and they seem not to know any English, but we always smile and nod hello. If there were more Hispanic families, maybe this neighborhood could be called Little Havana, though I don't think many Hispanics are from Cuba, so that really wouldn't be accurate. No, Little Hanoi makes more sense. I just have to stick with it, and eventually it'll catch on. Just when I thought I was going to vomit from the putrid poultry smell, I saw the lights of the bus coming to the corner. I know most people complain about SEPTA and public transportation in general, but I like riding the subway, bus, and trolley. I see people riding public transit that I wouldn't encounter anywhere else. These people certainly aren't going to pay $4.50 for a caramel latte. Riding SEPTA keeps me connected to real people. You'd think after 2 years of riding the same route every day that I'd get to know the drivers, but you'd be wrong. I always say hello when I enter the bus and thank you when I exit, but beyond that, I wouldn't recognize a driver if he or she were to punch me in the face. It's a short bus ride to the coffee shop from my apartment. Sometimes I put in my iPod, sometimes I pull out a book to read, but usually I just sit and listen. Despite the signs encouraging proper etiquette on SEPTA buses, everyone talks on their cell phones, completely oblivious to those around them. Sometimes I take out my moleskin notebook, you know, the kind that Kerouac and Hemingway used, and jot down things people say. One of my favorite overheard conversations comes courtesy of a black man in his mid-40s talking to his son, it seemed, and went something like this. "This is the last time. Your mother and I aren't going to bail you out again. You are 23 years old and need to start acting like it. You think I had someone bail me out? No, I made mistakes and paid for them. Next time, you will too. Stop hanging out with those friends of yours. You see, they only get you into trouble. You best wise up, son, because we will not help you out after this." I wonder what kind of person would have such a private conversation in a public place. But then again, who am I to judge? I'll tell you who I do judge, silently, of course. The customers at work. Today was a long shift, 9 hours. I was covering for some girl who was on vacation. Unlike the bus drivers, I'd recognize these people anywhere. What is it about coffee shop regulars? Don't they have jobs? How can they afford to sit in a coffee shop for hours in the middle of the day, on a weekday, just reading the paper? If I didn't dislike them so much, I'd ask what line of work they were in, because it seems like a pretty good setup to me. After work, I stopped at Lorenzo's in the Italian market for a slice of pizza and a Coke. It was a nice night, not too hot, now that the sun was setting. To the west, the sky looked like it was made of sherbet, like my nanny used to give me for dessert. All soft oranges, yellows, and pinks. I love the sky in South Philly. No smog like LA or fog like San Francisco. Granted, I've never been to those cities, but it seemed like the sky over Philadelphia was a sky you'd see in the country. And the rooftops. I love the rooftops in South Philly. My apartment's on the third floor of a building on a block of mostly two-story homes. Sometimes I'll spend hours staring at the view out my bedroom window, tar beaches stretching to the horizon, and the lights of the Walt Whitman Bridge blinking their eternal Morse code. If you got rid of the TV antenna and the satellite dishes, the view would be the same as it was a century ago. There's something comforting in that. I sat down at one of the tables outside Lorenzo's to eat my pizza and watch the hipster kids pass by. Though I'm the right age to be a hipster, and I have a hipster job, and I live among them, I am not a hipster. Let me repeat that. I am not a hipster. Yes, I do have long, dark hair with straight bangs, and I wear dark-framed glasses, and yes, I wear all-stars and dark jeans, but I am not a hipster. I just want to make that clear before we continue. So these three hipster guys were standing across the street, waiting for the light to change. Just as I finished my Coke, the tallest of the three happened to look my way, and we made eye contact. He smiled, and I smiled back. We kept looking at each other until the light changed, and his friends grabbed his arm. They disappeared into 12 steps down. Walking home, I didn't feel any different. He was just a guy, and we exchanged a look. I didn't give him another thought. But later that night, I was dragged from my sleep by what I thought was a baby crying. It turned out to be an alley cat. Have you ever heard an alley cat sound like a human baby? It's unnatural. I guess it was in heat, and the sound was awful. I'm a little superstitious, and though I stopped going to church years ago, I suppose some of the devil stuff they drill into you in Catholic school is still with me. To this day, I refuse to watch Rosemary's Baby or The Exorcist. That cat sounded too human to be normal. I couldn't fall asleep after that, and every noise I heard, I imagined was someone or something trying to get into my apartment. As I lay there, staring up into the darkness, I tried to think about other things. I thought about other sounds, happy sounds, from childhood summers down in my old neighborhood at 17th and Rittner. St. Monica's church bells, the Mr. Softy ice cream truck, Harry Callis announcing Phil's games, my Nana's Frank Sinatra records, morning doves at twilight. After all that, my thoughts ended up with that guy I'd seen earlier that night. He was cute, I had to admit. Even though I don't usually respect the hipsters, even though I thought they were pretentious and generally just took up space and practiced poor personal hygiene, I'd felt something when our eyes met. "Christ, listen to yourself," I said to my empty bedroom. "You sound like an idiot." I got up, got a drink of water from the kitchen, and headed back to bed. I tried to think cool thoughts. I'd heard about Buddhist monks living high in the Himalayas in Tibet who could enter into meditative states where they could melt snow with their minds. That skill would have come in handy right about now, but all I could think of was whether humidity could suffocate a person. I felt like I was suffocating, and I was becoming restless. With each movement, the sheets clung more to my body, so I decided to sleep on top of them. I wished I were the type of person who would be comfortable sleeping naked, but 12 years of Catholic school made that impossible. One of the first lessons I learned at St. Monica's was that God wants our bodies to be covered. There were only two IHM sisters at St. Monica's when I went there, Sister Mary Donald and Sister Judith. To be fair, Sister Colleen was also there, but she just sold the hot pretzels to us kids during recess, and she didn't talk much. When my mother went to school there in the late 60s, almost all the teachers were nuns. In her day, they used to hit the kids with rulers. I would have gladly been hit daily with a ruler if it meant I could be excused from gym. It wasn't just that I hated playing basketball or running relays. All through grade school, I used to dread changing for gym class. I was always a little on the heavy side, I suppose I still am, and never felt comfortable getting undressed in front of the other girls in my class. To make matters worse, I began developing, or blossoming, as Sister Judith called it, before any of the other girls. In second grade, my mom made me get a training bra, and though she was just doing her job and being a good mom, I hated that bra. It was white with a little pink rosette in the center. It was embarrassing, and every time I looked down at my chest, that little rosette seemed to be laughing at me. As I got older, the other girls started to wear bras, and it didn't bother me so much, but I never got comfortable with exposing myself. Even when I'm by myself, I tend to avoid changing in front of mirrors. Flipping onto my stomach, I stretched out my arms and buried my face in the mattress and thought about the snow-capped Himalayas. I guess I finally fell asleep because my alarm woke me at 8:30 again. This time I decided to take a shower and even washed my hair. Maybe I'd see that guy again, I thought. Buoyed at the prospect, I swung my legs out of bed, knocking the glass of water over that I'd left on the floor. The glass shattered. Without thinking, I ran to the bathroom to get a towel to mop up the water and stepped on a piece of glass. The shard cut through my flesh like a knife through butter. Fuck, fuck, fucking shit, fuck! I fell to the floor, my eyes filling with tears. It's times like these that I wish I still lived at home. The thought of pulling this piece of glass out of my foot was making me nauseous. If I still lived with my mom, I'd have her do it. She's much better at dealing with cuts and blood than I am. I hate blood, especially my own. I consider calling her and asking her to come over to take care of this. She's only a 5-minute drive away, after all. But it's Wednesday, her day off, and I don't want to bother her. No, you're an adult now. You can do this yourself, I say out loud. Then I took hold of the shard and in one swift movement pulled it out of my foot. It hurt, but wasn't that bad. I fully expected to pass out, but I didn't. I hobbled over to the bathroom and got some Band-Aids and Neosporin. It was still bleeding, so I sat there on the bathroom floor, holding some toilet paper to the cut. After a few minutes, I bandaged the cut and tried to walk on the outside of my foot. I considered calling out of work, but I didn't want to have to stay inside my apartment all day, just in case. You really are an idiot, I said to myself. You see a nice guy once and what? You're in love? How pathetic. You probably won't even see him again. Work was more awful than usual. Standing on your feet for 6 hours when one of them, your feet, not the hours, was recently torn open is not a good idea for anyone who isn't a masochist. My mystery guy did not come into the coffee shop, so at around 3 o'clock, I told my coworker, Julia, that I needed to leave early. Nodding absentmindedly, she barely looked up from her Nietzsche and said, "Okay, just mark it on your timesheet." So much for being a valued employee whose health and well-being is of the utmost concern. I thought I'd go to Lorenzo's and grab a slice of pizza, then maybe stop by 12 steps down for a drink. Leaving the Bean Exchange, I felt confident, bold even. But then, the closer I got to the Italian market, the more I felt like going home. Finally, with Lorenzo's and the bar just a block away, I turned down Catherine to catch the 47 back to my apartment. I mean, I was comfortable in my routine. Why start hoping for something that wasn't going to happen, right? I called out of work yesterday. I called early and left a message with Eve, the manager. She did not sound pleased, but I told her I'd cut my foot and needed to get it looked at today. Technically, I wasn't lying. I was going to see my mom later, and she is a nurse, and I would have her look at it. Really, though, the cut was healing fine, and I just wanted to go visit my Nana. A few years ago, my grandfather died, and my Nana didn't take it very well. That's putting it lightly. She was a mess for months after the funeral. Then she started talking to my grandfather as if he was still around. "Frank, did you put the trash out?" Or, "Do you want meatballs or brujol, Frank?" That sort of thing. Then one day, about a year ago, she fell in the bathtub, and after a few days in the hospital, she just seemed to have given up. My mom lived on the same street, just a few houses down, and could have moved in, I suppose. But she worked with sick people all day, and I think, though she didn't want to admit it, the thought of coming home from work to deal with her sick mother would have been too much for her. So my mom and aunt put my Nana in a nursing home. Even though my Nana was slowly becoming more detached from reality, the one thing she clung to was her religion. At 83 years old, the only thing that had been constant in her life was the Catholic Church. My mom and aunt finally decided on St. Ignatius Nursing Home on Haverford Ave in West Philly. I woke late, around 10 a.m. It was too hot to eat, so after changing the Band-Aid on my foot, I got dressed and headed out the door. On my way downstairs, I ran into, or more accurately, stepped on, a small Vietnamese girl who was playing on my landing. Cursing Gus and all slumlords, I made another mental note to call him about the lights in the hallway. The little girl started to cry, and just as I was bending down to make sure she was okay, an ancient Vietnamese woman, presumably the little girl's grandmother, bolted out of the second floor apartment, clearly very agitated. She grabbed the little girl by the arm and shouted something at me. Then, dragging the girl down the hall, went into the apartment and slammed the door. It'll be nice to have neighbors, I thought. Hurrying past Rocky, who was occupied talking to another little Hanoi resident, I started my slow trek up 7th to Lombard to catch the 40 bus to St. Ignatius. By the time I arrived at the nursing home, I was soaked in sweat. Walking down the hallway to her room, past the nursing station, I could feel everyone's disapproving eyes on me. I poked my head in room 312. My Nana was sitting in a chair by the window, just staring at the clouds. "Hi, Nana," I said. "Oh, hello, Ruth." "No, Nana, it's me, Allison. Ruth is my mom, your daughter." "Yes, yes, we're going to the boardwalk later. Your father is still sleeping, but when he wakes up, we'll go." She was having a bad day. I just pulled up a chair next to her and sat holding her hand. She talked about my grandfather and the summer they'd spent renting a beach house on Long Beach Island. My mom was only a little girl at the time, but for some reason, my Nana thought I was her. I stayed until it got dark and then walked home. My foot started bleeding about halfway, but I liked the pain. It made me feel alive. When I woke up this morning, I was still reeling from yesterday's walk, but I couldn't afford to take off from work again. The forecast predicted thunderstorms, and the clouds were thick and angry over the rooftops. So, grabbing an umbrella, I headed downstairs to wait for the bus. I could hear shouts from inside the second floor apartment. I wondered how many people were going to live there. It was the same size as mine, and I couldn't imagine a whole family being comfortable in such a small space. A breeze had picked up, and little cyclones of litter were forming in the streets. Rocky was nowhere to be seen, and the Vietnamese butcher shop employees were bringing in the cages. I could hear thunder off in the distance. I hope my Nana was okay. Sometimes thunder frightened her, like it does small children and some dogs. I contemplated ditching work and going to sit with her again, but I didn't want to get fired. When I got to work, the rain was just starting to fall. The front door was propped open, and the wind was whipping up the flyers on the community bulletin board. Pilates classes, yoga classes, a reggae band seeking a singer, a dog sitter offering her services, were all seconds away from tearing free from their pushpins and flying off into the sky. "Allison, bring in the sandwich board, will you?" Eve barked. "Sure," I mumbled. The rain was falling harder now. I could see a guy hurrying down the sidewalk towards the cafe. As he came near, I realized it was the same guy I'd seen the other night outside of 12 Steps Down. "Hey," he said, rainwater pouring off his face. I blushed. Though I'd wanted to see him again, I didn't want it to be at work, with me looking like I just climbed out of the Delaware. "Hi," I said, averting his eyes. I went back inside and tried to hide behind the counter. No luck. "I saw you the other night, right? Outside Lorenzo's?" "Oh, I don't know. I mean, yeah, I guess that could have been me." "Brilliant." He smiled. "I'm Jeremy." "Allison." I smiled back, still blushing furiously. He was even better looking than I thought. The rain had made his dark hair seem darker, and his eyes were hazel like mine. His skinny jeans and white V-neck undershirt suggested he was a hipster, but I didn't mind. "So, do you live in South Philly?" "Yeah, a few blocks from here, in Little Hanoi." "Little Hanoi?" Jeremy looked confused. "Oh, yeah, I mean, it's what I call my neighborhood, because, you know, all the Vietnamese families?" He smiled again. "Little Hanoi. I like it." I couldn't believe this conversation was happening, and to think I almost called out of work today. I was trying to think of something clever to say when the bell above the door interrupted my thoughts. The girl was an advertisement for Urban Outfitters summer line. She was tall, thin, beautiful. Recently, against my better judgment, I saw the movie 500 Days of Summer. Queen of the hipsters, Zooey Deschanel, played the main character, Summer. I hated her character, and now here I was face to face with a girl who could have been her stand-in. "Hey, Jeremy," fake Zooey said. "Why did you want to meet me here, of all places? This place sucks." Then, as an afterthought, "No offense," she said to me. "Hey, Hank, it's close by. It's pouring out. It's not that bad." "Hank? Hank?" Of course this girl's name was Hank. A jaw-droppingly beautiful woman would be named after a tobacco-chewing baseball legend or a country western icon. I hated her, instantly and utterly. "This is Allison." "I'll have a spiced chai tea," Hank said before moving towards a table in the back of the shop. I nodded, staring at the countertop. And for you? I knew I couldn't look at him. If I did, I'd probably start crying. I'd never look like Hank. And of course, Jeremy dated girls like Hank, not girls like me, whose clothes are stained with sweat and coffee. A loud thunderclap forced my head up. Looking out the window, I could see the wind ripping leaves from their branches. Just a coffee. He put his money on the counter, and something snapped. Literally. A bolt of lightning hit a tree across the street, sending the branch to the pavement. Hank screamed. Eve came running out from the back office. Jeremy moved closer to the window. And it was then that I decided to make my exit. Eve, I quit. What? Why? Wait, you can't just quit. Everyone else is on vacation. Goodbye, Eve. As I walked past Jeremy, I could feel his eyes on my face, but I kept my gaze fixed straight ahead. I stepped out into the rain. The smell of charred wood and electricity hung in the air. It smelled like freedom. I felt like dancing. The thunder was like applause and the lightning erratic stage lights. I was about a block from my apartment when I realized in my moment of glory I'd forgotten my bag. Too late to go back now. I'd stop by to pick it up tomorrow. I hoped that Gus's negligence would pay off and the front door would be open. I began running the last block, and with the raindrops beating my skin, threw myself against the door. It opened. Once inside, with the door closed behind me, it was dark as night in the landing. Feeling my way for the railing, I began to make my way up to the third floor. It was hot in the hallway, and the thunder didn't sound like an enraptured audience anymore. Truthfully, I was already having doubts about my decision. I needed that job. As I reached the second floor, I heard the front door open. I paused, like an animal ready to flee or pounce. Hello? It was a man's voice, an unfamiliar voice. My heart began to beat, a nervous tattoo in my chest. Anybody home? Shit. I started to make my way silently upstairs, but the steps creaked, a protest to my presence. Hello? The voice called. He was coming upstairs. I started to run, silently cursing the darkness. I just want to talk to you. I got to my door and reached up for the spare key on the door ledge. Flipping the switch, my living room stayed dark. The electricity must have gone out. The storm outside reached its peak, and the stranger had reached my doorway. A flash of lightning illuminated his silhouette. I ran to the kitchen and grabbed a knife, hoping to scare him off. Running back to the door, he was inside my apartment. I felt the knife connect with something soft. Someone screamed. The man fell down the stairs, dropping my bag at my feet. A door opened on the second floor landing. Light from the apartment poured on Jeremy's broken body. My new neighbors huddled around him, then looked up at me. They started yelling in Vietnamese, then, 911, call 911. I feel numb. I walk down the flight of stairs to him. Kneeling next to Jeremy's body, I lift his head in my hands. I look up at the Vietnamese family, huddled around Jeremy and me. Their mouths are moving, but I can't hear anything. Silently, stiffly, as if in a play, I rise and walk back up to my apartment. I can feel his blood warm and wet on my hands. I walk into my bedroom and sit on the floor next to the window. There they are, the rooftops. So familiar, so safe. The storm is making its retreat. The thunder is softer now, growing fainter, and the sky is red.
Stephanie, that was terrific. Thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
You're welcome.
Let's talk a little bit about it. First, it's very clearly a Philadelphia story.
Yes.
What about our city inspires you so much?
Well, I used to live at 7th and Greenwich. When I first moved to the city, that's where I lived. And I always did think that neighborhood should have had a name, because it doesn't. And
right.
The neighbor, Rocky, he's a real person. He lives on, he has no idea he's in this story, but he lives on Greenwich. And his character was taken from real life. The butcher shop, also coming from real life. The 47 bus, and my experience with riding the bus, also coming from real experiences I had. So a lot of it just, it seemed to me so vibrant. So much of what I was seeing and hearing, and I had never lived in the city before, right? I grew up in Bucks County in kind of bland suburbs, right?
Okay.
Just to sort of tell you where I'm coming from. So coming to the city when I was a teenager was a very exciting ordeal. Right. And it was something like that I both looked forward to but was always kind of nervous about, because the mm-hmm. city's the bad, scary place. Right. So I'm kind
yes.
of building on
from
those.
Bucks County, sure.
Coming from Bucks County, you know, the city, people are murdered in the city every day. Someone's going to push you in front of a subway train. You know, all these are the things that like were somehow drilled into my head. Right. So and then, you know, fast forward years later when I actually moved to the city and I see that, you know, well, it's not really a frightening place. It's a wonderful place. And you know, there's so much always happening, and I felt that it just again, like I had said earlier, that I don't really think I'm going to write a story about my neighborhood. It just sort of wrote itself, just from actually, you know, living in the area. So
sort of everyday experiences conglomerate into the setting.
Yes.
For what we certainly hope is not a true story.
It
in
is
the
not.
End.
It is not. I'm not, and I and no one that I know has accidentally murdered anyone.
This is a good thing.
Right.
But the story so much interweaves the city and the neighborhood of South Philly, the unnamed part of South Philly,
right.
As a character, and you really are able to bring sort of setting to life as being an interactive part of the story. And then you weave this woman, Allison's personal life, into her surroundings, and then this climactic moment that we as readers really don't see coming.
Mm-hmm.
And I love the distinction that you draw between the hipsters and her, although she really kind of is one.
She just doesn't.
How do you work on
it.
Creating this character? She's so multifaceted and so oblivious to herself in a lot of ways.
Well, parts of her are coming from people that I know and have known. I guess some of her is a little bit of me, but I try not to put a lot of me into my characters.
Mm-hmm.
12 years of Catholic school, you know, that's sort of, that might be actually where she and I, and the Italian heritage, that might be where she and I sort of stop having things
okay.
in common. But certainly, like, I've known people who are very anti-hipster and who are just kind of cynical people and who hate their job, but they don't seem to want to change their job. You know, at one point,
right.
Allison's envying the people who come to, you know, how can they come to work, or how do they, you know, sit in a coffee shop all day? Don't they have jobs? And then, I have a job, but I oftentimes can sit in a coffee shop during the day as a
True.
Professor, right?
You know? We have that luxury so, occasionally.
Exactly. So this is something that, you know, if Allison wanted, and we don't know a great deal of her background, you know, we know she's from South Philly, you know, 17th and Rittner, Italian heritage. You know, we see a little bit of discussion of her mom. There's no mention of a father, you know, so
right.
There's an aunt mentioned. So a lot of her background is a mystery. And I purposefully, I didn't want to give too much because I wanted more to have the story to be about the event, this kind of changing event, and not, you know, filling in every little gap in her history. You know, the reader can kind of fill in some of those
sure.
for themselves.
And that's fun for us as readers or listeners to be able to fill in all those details that are left out.
Mm.
And yet we see so much of her intimate life, so much of these daily moments. And as readers, we think that's where the story is going, that this is a character piece about a young woman and what her daily life is like. And that's tremendously interesting for us to hear.
Mm-hmm.
And then we sort of see this climactic moment foreshadowed by what could be, you know, just another kind of sad little occurrence in her life, the meeting of this cute guy on the street corner.
Right.
Which
right.
isn't even really quite a meeting.
No, they just exchange a look, you know, and I guess I kind of wanted to play with that idea of, you know, that we, and this is obviously an extreme example, you know, what happens at the end of the story here, but the idea that when you leave your home in the morning that you never know what could happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which is a very common theme, you know, in a lot of writing and a lot of film. But I think it's something that maybe because it's so true, it never gets tired.
Exactly. When we leave every morning, we never know what our day is going
mm-hmm.
to be like. So I think, the story has so much appeal because it's very true to what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And the narrative voice and the way she sort of notices everything and resists the urge to meditate on everything or to make it into some grand philosophy is also very true of the way a lot of people think.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I hope that she's a sympathetic character.
Oh, I think she is.
You know, she, I always, after, you know, sort of writing a piece, I always think that I could, you know, revise. So there is more
than,
exactly. So there's, I think, more that could be done, you know, with the story, but I'm really happy with how I think you mentioned earlier that this, the city is almost like a character, you know, the setting
yeah.
has become a character. And I'm glad that, you know, came through because that was definitely an intention as I started writing this because, again, the city is alive, you know, and for it to have its own voice almost, you know, because I mean, when I, you know, walk out, I've been living in the city now for 3 years and I don't live in South Philly anymore. But I still, every day I see something new that is just remarkable.
Well, I think for our audience, for all of us who read your work, who are part of this vibrant city, we can feel that as well.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that you wanted to make Allison a sympathetic character. Is that something that's important to you as a writer, that your reader can connect and have empathy with your characters?
Tremendously. So, yes. And I think that's because as a reader, I appreciate that from writers. You know, the writers that I admire and their works that I most enjoy are the writers who, you know, successfully make me feel for their characters.
What writers do you admire? Do you model your writing on anyone?
I wouldn't say that I model my writing on anyone, but writers, I love J.D. Salinger. When I was younger, I did try to, you know, copy, essentially, you know, Salinger's. I've got a collection of short stories that I've never shared with anyone and probably never will, that I wrote when I was an undergrad.
Oh, and someday and there'll be a guy across the street and you'll share them with him.
Maybe. and they're, you know, in that style of sort of, you know, Salinger. Contemporary writers, I love, most of the writers that I admire are from maybe the, you know, 40, 50 years ago. I don't know why that is. Yeah. Maybe, I mean, Kerouac, you know, Kerouac gets a little mention in here because she writes in her Moleskin, which, you know, the Hemingway. But Sylvia Plath, I mean, I wish that I love her poetry, and of course she gave us The Bell Jar, but, you know, I wish that she had written 20 more novels. But
this is very different characteristically than the writers you admire. That's very interesting.
Yeah, I guess the only thing that I maybe would try to say that, you know, maybe that you see similarities are that, you know, that you care for the character.
Mm-hmm.
You know, other than that, I don't think I really do kind of emulate those writers who I most admire.
That's
I'm
great,
not sure
though.
Why that is, yeah.
You're more original then. I think that's tremendous.
Okay.
What do you want your writing to do for you, and what do you want it to do for your audience?
Well, for me, it's very selfish. I mean, I just, you know, I don't often share my poetry with others, because that, again, to go back to my kind of earlier comment about it being private, unless you want it to be for an audience. So when I write poetry, it's very self-serving. You know, I have these ideas and I like the way certain words sound, so I put them down to paper, but I don't want to expose them to that critic, you know, that outside critic, or I don't want them.
Fair enough.
You know, so that's very, very selfish. The short stories, I feel like, you know, if a writer or if a reader can just be entertained, I'm not necessarily looking to, like, inform or educate or enlighten, you know. I know that a lot of times writers try to have a moral of some kind. I'm not really trying to get my audience to think, really. You know, my academic writing.
To feel.
And just kind of enjoy, which sounds maybe.
So refreshing, though.
Yeah, okay.
So many writers have, like, grand things that they want to accomplish, and we forget that people read for pleasure.
Just, you know, that you don't need to spend a lot of time struggling with it to understand, you know, well, was that symbolic of what? Which is great. I mean, I love doing that
Certainly.
As well. But for my own, you know, short fiction, I just really would like the audience to just enjoy it, just maybe see something that they can kind of relate to, perhaps, make it familiar, again, either the character being sympathetic or, in this case, the setting being familiar. I would hope that, you know, maybe anyone who's been to South Philly could recognize, oh, yeah, that's pretty accurate. That is what it's like down there. And just maybe identify a little. But beyond that, not really striving for any great kind of earth-changing, you know, earth-shattering
I think that is absolutely tremendous, though, because the arts should be enjoyed. And to have art and an artist who wants her audience to enjoy her work, first and foremost, is really terrific.
Thank you.
There are some, though, symbolic moments, maybe.
Yes.
You mentioned you have Rocky as a character, and you said he's real. Is his name actually Rocky?
It actually is.
Oh, that's brilliant.
I have not changed his name. I never knew his last name. I don't know his last name.
I don't think it matters.
But he's essentially unchanged. The hey, how you been? I mean, that was what he always used to greet me with every time I walked out my front door.
It's so emblematic of the city, though, which is so then ironic, and then we have Rocky appearing in a Philadelphia story.
Right.
And then you mentioned Taxi Driver later in the story, and as we were talking off air, you presented work and studied sort of the similarities and differences between Rocky and Taxi Driver as they were, as you told me, nominated for the Oscar in the same year. So is that intentional in your story?
Not really. It might have been something that I was not fully aware of. It might have been in the back of my head. I remember, you know, seeing the first time that Rocky, my neighbor Rocky, opened up the hydrant and flooded the streets. The first thing I thought of was of, you know, again, that scene, you know, Travis Bickle wanting to cleanse the streets.
Right.
And I don't know that Rocky had ever seen the film. He doesn't seem to me to be someone who watches a lot of anything. So it might have been something that was kind of there, but it wasn't intentional.
So the unconscious coming through.
Yes, yeah. And I think that that happens a lot more often than we maybe, you know, admit or even recognize, that, you know, the fabric of our conscious and our subconscious and our lives are just made up of so many different things that, in fact, as I was reading this out loud, I came across a line that I remember thinking, like, I think I've heard this somewhere before. Right, so kind of a, I don't want to say that I, you know, plagiarized at all, but it was something that, like, someone else might have said, and it became part of me, and now it's part of, yeah, don't tell anybody, right? And
now, we won't tell anyone.
Yeah, we won't share that. So I think that, you know, because sometimes as writers, we have this idea of, like, the lone genius, you know, like, up in the room by his, you know, self or herself, and their, you know, divine inspiration, and... Well, yeah, but then, like, there's so much more that goes into it. You know, like, writing doesn't happen in a vacuum. Writers are inspired by, you know, everything in their lives. So writing, in a sense, is always kind of a collaborative process, if you think about it that way. You know?
I like that idea. And I think that's important for our audience to hear as well, because people do think of writing as being, like, a rarefied art that you have to work at and practice, and certainly you do.
Sure.
And clearly you do all of those things as well, but the idea that writing is a collaborative art is really interesting, I think.
Yeah, I mean, we do, I think, for some reason tend to, you know, when we look at sort of drama and, you know, music and other kind of art forms that are clearly more sort of... require
the input of many people.
So yeah,
done in a group setting,
right.
In collaboration.
Right. We don't often classify writing as in, you know,
no,
to fall
I think
there.
That's true.
But it is. You know, it's you're inspired somewhere. You're picking up things somewhere, and then you're just putting them down, you know, on paper.
So then, if you had one bit of advice for all of our audience members who want to write, what would you give them? Would it be to collaborate with the world around them?
Yeah. I mean, keep your eyes and ears open. And when things don't let the moment pass you by. When you do feel like, you know, if you're standing on that street corner and you see a mom with her child, and you look at them and you wonder what their backstory is, and that write that down, you know, like start and then just kind of chronicle. Be a chronicler of your life, you know. And I think that stories, you know, true stories are in some way, you know, inevitably going to follow if you're just kind of open to the world.
Well, great advice. Thank you for being with us tonight. And
thank you
for sharing your story and your story.
Thanks.
Good night. And thank you, audience. Good night.